Prabhjot Singh is the director of the Arnold Institute for Global Health and chairman of the Department of Health System Design and Global Health at Mount Sinai Health System in New York City. He's also the co-founder of the 1 Million Community Health Worker Campaign, an initiative of the African Union and the UN Sustainable Development Solutions Network, and was himself a founding technical advisor of City Health Works, a Harlem-based organization that works to decrease the costs of healthcare by training and hiring locally based health coaches. A Robert Wood Johnson Foundation Young Leader, a Truman National Security Fellow, and a member of the Council on Foreign Relations, Prabhjot joins us this evening to discuss his first book, Dying and Living in the Neighborhood, A Street-Level View of America's Healthcare Promise. Please join me in offering a warm town hall welcome to Prabhjot Singh.
Wow, I can't see any of you. what an incredible pleasure to be here. It's a real joy to be here and speak with you. I want to just get a quick view of the room. So many wonderful friends to see. Thank you. I'd love to just get a quick sense of who's in the room. How many of you are related to health in some fashion? You have some role. Wow. Okay. I guess all are humans and have health. or desire to. Fantastic. And how about other just interested in the topic and concerned citizens? Okay, great. There's an overlap. Fantastic. It's a real joy to be here today, for a couple reasons. One is that actually, I'm not sure if you followed your own Washington news, we noticed that the University of Washington just received about $250 million dollars for global health from the Gates Foundation today, which is incredible. And It's really wonderful at a time when to see an investment in engaging the world when there is so much discussion about retrenching and focusing on the US. And I think one of the most important things, if you truly believe in having America being competitive and doing the best, it means that you have to be open to learning from anywhere in order to do that. And I think it's a great commitment on this day. There was also another piece of interesting news today, and it's to those that are close readers of some of the professional journals, the New England Journal of Medicine today. I don't know if anybody caught that the sign-off was the former president of the United States wrote a perspectives and editorial piece, signed as Barack Obama as former president, which is the first time I've seen that in print. And in really a, I think, heartfelt, pointed, and full-throated editorial, he used the words reckless, irresponsible, and that undoing pieces can undo it all. And so you really hear the voice of concern entering in from the former president's perspective about what healthcare is going to look like in the upcoming few years. As I kind of put together these two things, you know, an investment in global health today, at least here, and to hear and read the same concern about domestic health, it really brings me back to how I've kind of come into thinking about American healthcare through a very potentially oblique lens. I grew up in Kenya, and some of my most formative experiences with learning about health was actually through doing work in rural parts of sub-Saharan Africa, where I spent time building community health worker systems and really understanding how deeply integrated healthcare, education, agriculture, small business development actually is. If you have kids, for example, that are going to school who are anemic because they have worms or parasites, they can't concentrate in school. If you give them anti-worm medications, their reading scores and test scores can shoot straight up. And so you really start to see these kind of deep integrations, which become very obvious in settings where life can be on the precipice, and it becomes very clear that you do have to think in an integrated manner. That's the habit of thought, you know, that I learned to think through as I went through my training, And I was trained in both medical school and did graduate work in a lab. And in coming to residency, you know, in the U.S., I trained in New York City, but as I was here in the U.S., you really are brought into a radically different view of healthcare. And I want to speak a little bit about these two very different views of what health in America looks like and what healthcare looks like. But one thing's clear, whether it's that note of concern that we saw, that I heard in our former president's voice, is that we're in a period of unprecedented experimentation with what healthcare should be. Nothing since 1965, when Medicare and Medicaid was passed in the United States, the Affordable Care Act in 2011 was one of the most seismic pieces of legislature, which unfolded during a lot of my training, and I saw care change during that time. And we're about to enter in another cataclysmic moment that's going to shake it even further, one way or another. And there's many paths that it can go down. And so this is a period of time when not only the mechanics of healthcare and what it can or should be will be contested, but actually what constitutes a real approach that this country should take to creating health. And whether one likes the approach or not, we will have 1,000 opportunities, hundreds of thousands of opportunities across the country to actually seeing it playing out in very different ways. When I started this work and really thinking about healthcare after I finished my training, I was a professor at the International Affairs School at Columbia. And I worked across middle and low income countries, and I was thinking about America in the same way that I was thinking about healthcare from a policy perspective and a financial perspective. And so in that view, as a professor of policy, I really thought about American healthcare as being this enormous industrial sector. And if you think about how large American healthcare is, you have to put it in proportion. If it was a country, it would be the size by gross domestic product between France and Brazil. It would have 26 million people, but no formal system of governance. And it would be, and it is today, moving rapidly towards being a quarter of the US economy, which is stunning in part because it means that even over the last decade, any real growth of income that Americans have had over the last 12 to 15 years has been wiped out entirely by growth in healthcare costs. So whether you like it or not, you have anything to do with health as a sector or not, it is like a incredibly aggressive neighbor moving up into you, onto you, and pushing onto you and squeezing onto you. And it's what's really amazing is if you think about Massachusetts, which is in many ways was 5 years ahead of the country in the creation in essentially prototyping what we call the Affordable Care Act. Massachusetts, a state where the protection of social services, of education, and so forth, you can imagine in a very progressively oriented state is going to be protected at every turn. 5 years in, they found that healthcare had squeezed the economy so much that in every category of social sector spending, healthcare, education, transportation, other sort of infrastructure was down 20% in every category. And so the growth in healthcare costs as a sector, you know, is truly has been squeezing states and the country. So as I looked at it as a professor, you know, I saw this industrial sector and what it really requires if you think about it from just a pure policy and economic perspective, which is the dominant lens that created the Affordable Care Act, is that you need a strong sector strategy to contain costs and improve outcomes. And think about it in terms of how do you reorganize an industry? And think about all of its actors, the healthcare providers, the physicians, the payers. And you have to think about these categories of pharmaceuticals, and then think about all the things you have to legislate and organize and to make sure that the economics all works out. And it was really in that spirit that the Affordable Care Act was forged as a sector strategy. But there's another view, and I want to share how this turns into human stories in a moment. But there's another view where healthcare or health in America is about 300 million people that are folded in their values, their approaches, their need for a healthy life. There are 300 million people. They live in 50 states. And in these 50 states, there's 3,000 counties. In these 3,000 counties, there's 200,000 neighborhoods. And these 300 million people live in those 200,000 neighborhoods. And when you think about it that way, you don't see a sector and its consolidative effort of kind of organizing it as an industry. Instead, you just start to see our streetscapes, our landscapes. You start to see that health lives and moves or doesn't around neighborhoods, around the jobs that you have or you don't, around the opportunities you have or you don't. And they actually offer very contrasting views of what health, what does it take for this country to be healthier? Or what does it take for us to have a sound strategy around healthcare? And I'll tell you that as a professor of policy, there aren't very many good tools to think about that latter view. It's in some ways overwhelming. It is the life that we're immersed in, and it is complicated. And it's hard to find all the one or two or three, if you're going to give the policy speech, scalable solutions that'll just address it all. And yet, it becomes so challenging because you have to somehow still articulate what is it that you want to see. And so these are powerfully contrasting views. But let me give you some idea of what's happened since 1965 to 2015 that makes that latter view more important of the neighborhoods. Americans are moving less. It used to be a country where you got in your Winnebago, your family moved from Cleveland to another part of the country. People were moving from the city that they grew up in and went elsewhere. But Americans are moving far less than they ever did. And actually, nobody knows why. It's one of these big question marks in economics. Second is that America is far less socially mobile and economically mobile than it ever was before. If you're born in the bottom quintile socioeconomically, you're likely to stay there, and vice versa. So we're moving less geographically, we're less socially mobile. And what that essentially means is that the place where you're born matters immensely. It matters far more than it might have even 50 years ago. And so thinking about health and what produces health or doesn't produce health, thinking about that latter view, this complicated, messy view of 200,000 neighborhoods becomes essential. You have to develop a way to at least think about it. And in some ways, the sector view is just embedded inside all of that too. But it is not the dominant lens. And I just want to give you that for a moment to think about it. If you are a citizen looking out on what health may mean for you, you're looking at it alongside every other checkbook issue or kitchen table issue and the pressures that you have. But if you're thinking about it as a policymaker and what do we do to reform this sector, it's a very different set of strategies. And in many ways, these, for good people that are trying to drive both, there are conflicts between the two. And I would have spent most of my career and time in view number one, in the sector strategy view, because that's in many ways how I was trained as a scientist, and then economics training, and then in policy training. It was to really think about it logically and strategically. What are the three bullet points, the five bullet points? What are the costs? What are the legislative implements? What do you have to do to scale this? That is the view that I was taught and got good at watching and learning. I had a fortunate, incredible experience of being both a professor at SIPA and actually being a resident at the same time. So I was a resident in internal medicine at Mount Sinai Hospital, where I trained in at Mount Sinai Hospital, which is on the border of one of the richest zip codes in the country, which is the Upper East Side, and one of the poorest, which is East Harlem. And we also trained at Elmhurst Hospital in Queens, which is one of the most diverse boroughs, or is, I think, in the country. And also at the Veterans Hospital in the Bronx. And I would dip in and out. That was my arrangement. I would do about 6 months of residency, or 3 months sometimes, or 2 months, and then I would go back and teach, and I would travel, and I would think about the sector. And I would always have my view, you know, like waves upon clear, fluid thought on my professor's side, hit up against the beachhead of reality when I entered my resident view. And it was jarring every single time I made that transition. Within a few days, maybe a week or two of me entering residency, I encountered a gentleman that I write about in this book, a man named Ray. At that point, I was in the emergency department doing my rotation there and then on the floors in the hospital. And Ray came on in. I didn't know really anything about him. He just came in and there was a bit of a scattered record. I knew he was an elderly man. He came in and he looked like he was doing very poorly. He wasn't speaking clearly. We thought, oh, he might have had a stroke. His daughter said, no, he's Southern. And so we said, send him for an MRI. And we just whisked him right through the process. And then she said, no. And we said, there's no stroke, to his daughter. She said, I know, he's Southern. And he's always sounded like this. And so we said, okay, fine. And you know where that bill went. And he continued down a set of tests, and he was starting to just kind of lose interactivity. It was unclear what was going on with him. So he sent through a battery of other tests, and she asked, do you need to repeat these? He was actually just 10 days ago at Harlem Hospital. And we said, oh, didn't realize that. But we can't get those records, so yes, we're gonna repeat them. And things just started deteriorating. We had no idea what was exactly going on. And he was sent to the intensive care unit. And at that point, he was off of my service. I didn't really know what happened to him. That was that. And in many ways, this is the story of a lot of medical training in that period. You intensively focus upon what you should have done during a period of time. You're given a piece of process. You execute upon it as well as you can. And I think we did a great job executing upon it, the part that we had, that little sliver of his life. We just, you know, did our job. And then he vanished. And he went to another service, and they probably did that too. And that was that. I didn't think about it very much. I lived in Harlem, and as I was walking home one day, I heard his daughter, except I didn't recognize his daughter, because I found it hard to recognize people when they were not in the hospital floor outside. So I said, boy, who's this woman? She's saying, Dr. Singh, Dr. Singh. I want to tell you about my father. He died. And I couldn't even locate who she was, had no idea. And then it kind of slowly dawned on me as we had a conversation, mentioned he was Southern. And I was like, oh, it's that lady. And she said, you know, thank you so much for what you did. It was really meaningful, especially the rapport you struck with him. And I was like, I don't remember him, you know, to myself. And in some ways, it's tragic and comic, and it's more tragic as we start to think about what are the habits that we build inside the people we train to be our doctors. And she said, I'd like you to come to his funeral. And I was 3 weeks into internship, and if I was maybe 6 months into internship, I'd have been like, nope, too busy, too tired. But I was 3 weeks in, and I said, sure. It's just a few blocks away from where I lived. And so I went to his funeral, and I learned all about this man who, from his nieces, his nephews, from the veterans that served with him in the Vietnam War, I learned all about a man that I got to know really when he died, and only afterwards. And it was really, I think, important for me. I had just moved to the neighborhood, to Harlem, and it was a great way for me to begin to understand a place that I, in some ways, just kind of inhabited as a wave of gentrifiers in many ways that moved to the neighborhood and got to know just a few of its residents in that time. Got to know his church, got to know people around him. And it would turn out that that's very important later on for me. But I think it also just stuck with me. You know, it really created a real sense of dissonance What is it that we're doing, you know, in total? What does this add up to? And I know that actually many of my colleagues feel this way. We know that burnout in the field across all disciplines is skyrocketing. We know that during training, a staggering number of physicians and medical students feel both depression, and as I learned as my role as a faculty member at Mount Sinai, also commit suicide, our students and trainees. In shocking numbers, in numbers that you would say, this is a red cord, we need to change how we do things, but we keep on going. And so, you know, that stuck with me, and I over that time, I got to actually meet people in the neighborhood, and I got to be a little bit of a part of it. But not as much as I bounced back and forth between Columbia and Mount Sinai in my roles as I did in 2013. So by then, remember, in 2010, the Affordable Care Act was passed. 2011, you know, you wouldn't really have noticed too much related to it. A few technicalities that if you wanted to focus on the arcane elements of hospital policy, you would have started to see things starting to change. We didn't care just about them when they left the hospital. We cared about them for the next 30 days. And then on day 31, we reverted back. And so those were some of the changes, and it turned out over time they were meaningful in some ways. They set in motion changes of habits. They broke some habits and started to allow people to at least push and imagine different ways of doing things. And over time, there was just this slight creaking in that structure of how we did healthcare started to kind of open up, and you could tell a little bit when you were in training. But in some ways, it didn't really shift my mindset. But in 2013, I was walking in Harlem. I had just dropped off my wife and my son, of which we have two now, at my apartment, and I was walking with my younger brother in Harlem. And for some of you that are friends in the audience, you'd certainly remember in 2013, as I was walking there, I was attacked by about 20 to 30 men that called me Osama and a terrorist. And I had my jaw fractured at that time. And it made a significant amount of news. And there's a whole thread of a story that follows along that. But what really struck me most during that time was how much some of those small relationships that I had made in Harlem from that funeral in 2011 related to Ray, how much it just, in many ways, completely opened up the neighborhood to me. And I was genuinely, in a way that still deeply touches me, literally embraced in the streets. People apologized. People wanted to ask me how I was doing. I was taking a woman. I went back to work pretty quickly, and I was taking a woman up to the ICU. She couldn't breathe very well. She had a pneumonia that was quite severe. And I asked her, how are you doing? And she ripped off her mask, and she asked me, how are you doing, Dr. Singh? And it was really amazing. And I think during that period of time, what I also saw was starting to see how many different organizations across the neighborhood in their own ways started reaching out to me. And what touched them most was that after I was attacked, I did not feed a narrative that I was offered in the news, that this was a neighborhood engulfed with crime, and this is a reflection of the people of Harlem. And it was a narrative I rejected, along with a few others that are pertinent today, that you know you were mistakenly attacked because you were they thought you were Muslim, which is a deeply objectionable alternative narrative. But the neighborhood narrative was incredibly meaningful to Harlem, that they said, you know, that acknowledged that this was actually a really wonderful place to me. And the number of people that reached out, organizations from across the country, but particularly in Harlem, was astonishing. And what it did for me is have me understand these other strange and interesting ways that people are connected with a logic in a neighborhood that you would never really be able to see from the outside in. And so I could have sat at the periphery of Harlem at Columbia for the next 50 years, and I'd have never seen a different way that the neighborhood's organized, a different way that people interact with each other and rely upon each other in this place. Simple things. There's 400 churches in Harlem. There's an industry around it. There's so many different types of organizations that are there. There's a huge number of public housing buildings, and there are a whole range of ways that these services and communities are kind of interconnected. And yet, one thing that always struck me is that ringing a neighborhood that had extremely poor health outcomes were within 2 to 3 miles, 6 to 8 of some of the best hospitals on US News rankings you could find. In fact, there are enough beds in those hospitals to house every 1 out of 20 residents in Harlem permanently. And there's enough revenue flowing in that area, something on the order of $30 billion of healthcare revenue flowing all the way on the outside, to essentially subsidize, you know, annual all sorts of things for everybody that lives there. And yet, you start to see the staggering disconnect between the sector organization right around it and the way that the neighborhood is actually organized on the inside. And I don't think I would have seen it, and I hope that nobody else really has to be woken up in that way to be able to see, you know, what is a real way that a place can be composed. And I think what struck me most was that I could have lived there, I could have worked nearby, and never really seen the way a place was organized during that time. What happened, I think, next for me is that I became curious. I said, you know, okay, I've gotten a taste. I've been able to start to see the ways that people are organized in our neighborhood. If we go to places across the country, what is it that people are actually doing? While there's such a huge focus on sector-level reform, as there will be today, repeal, replace, you know, touch the ACA or don't touch the ACA, modifying it, so forth, they are important conversations, very important conversations, and yet they're also very high level. And they're still fundamentally about sector strategy. They are not conversations around what is it that we would like to see in that latter image. How would we like our neighborhoods to be organized? How would we like to live in places that actually allow us to be healthier? And those are the conversations that I wanted to listen to. And so I traveled across the country, and I looked for pioneers that were doing this work. So I went to places like, and I'll tell you about four of them, or three of them. I went to Parkland, Texas, Parkland Hospital, rather, in Dallas, which is a safety net hospital in Texas. Now, Texas is a state that had, at that time hadn't expanded in terms of expanding Medicaid coverage. And I think that changed. Somebody can check me on that. But the Parkland system was a safety net system. And at that time, I had encountered a gentleman named Ruben Amasaringham, who was a very tall, you know, lanky guy, a physician, who was also a technologist. And he had been thinking about how can we actually start to connect up this neighborhood. And he had a ray. You know, the same type of person that motivated him, he had also, I think, really been shaped by in his own training. And it was a person that would come to the clinic, come to the Parkland emergency room every week or month, over and over again, in a state that can be caused by not taking thyroid medications. And so, thyroid medications are cheap. You know, they cost, you know, dollars. And you just have to take them and keep your thyroid levels in check, and if you don't, you know, all sorts of things can happen. But this person would keep on coming back, keep on coming back, keep on coming back. And it's a really familiar story, actually, to a lot of people that have worked in hospital settings. And so what he had done is he had worked with, identified essentially how can he build essentially ways that community organizations all across all across Dallas could start actually, it turns out there was a racket on client management technology or kind of software for social service agencies. They'd be charged exorbitant rates. And so he said, let me just build something that would be close to free. And in that process, connect it to the health record system in Parkland. And so over the course of a couple years, it wasn't really the technology is what drew me to Dallas, but the way that he began asking the Dallas community of 400, 500 organizations, what is it that you'd want to know back and forth between the people that are moving around these organizations. The goals of what it looks like to succeed at a food pantry are very different from what it looks like for a hospital. What is valued at a shelter is also very different from what it might look like from an emergency room. The types of information that people wanted was very different. But there was never really a conversation around what would you want to know if we could just share that information with you. And so what was amazing is that, you know, you have never any idea, especially with technology, whether or not people, you know, if you build it, if they come. Often the answer is no. But there's a question about, is there a real process around it? And so what was amazing in Dallas is that 400 organizations came around to design, essentially, what would it look like to have an interconnected system here? And over the course of the next few years, what they did was actually any time that a person that they were concerned about actually went and was served by a community organization of any sort, the hospital would send them $100 just for kind of completing that interaction. Now, you have to understand the kind of financing of healthcare to understand how, like, in some ways simple this is. If any one of those patients came to Parkland Hospital, the average bill would be between $10,000 and $100,000. So sending out $100, you know, to an organization for just touching and making sure that things all connected, that everything that happened correctly for that person, instead of just throwing them out and hoping that they randomly got to 10 places or 5 places, and just making sure that actually happened, was actually something very important. And it turned out that it was incredibly motivating to a social service area that was in many ways starved for financing and support in a way that healthcare was, you know, overloaded by. And so that whole process really amazed me, mostly because it wasn't that the technology had moved people, but it was a way of organizing around common ideas that motivated most of Dallas to be connected up. And that still actually operates today. The challenge, though, is that if you're just thinking about this as a technology, information, and cost problem, you're in some ways missing the kind of like deep undercurrents of how do you actually change places. What does it actually take to change places isn't just about sending information and making sure that costs are contained. It's an important part of the equation, but it's not actually all of the work. For that, I had to go north. I went to Minnesota, and I got to spend quite a bit of time with an organization called Isaiah, led by an extraordinary woman named Doran Trance. And so I spent a time with essentially a Christian organizing, a faith-based organizing group, that at that time was in the midst of trying to unseat Tim Pawlenty. Tim Pawlenty was a governor at that time, and Mark Dayton then followed him. And the major issue that they had focused on was putting a light rail between St. Paul and Minneapolis. And at that time, Tim Pawlenty wanted to cut costs on the light rail and take out the 3 stops in between St. Paul and Minneapolis. And he wanted to take out these 3 stops because the neighborhoods themselves were very poor, and they wouldn't be big revenue drivers for subsidizing that light rail. And they did the analysis from a sheer economic perspective, and it made sense to connect St. Paul downtown and some of the suburbs and Minneapolis, because that would be, they would kind of experience and benefit from the economic growth. But if you actually built those extra 3 stops in there in these kind of poor and largely minority neighborhoods, the return on investment wouldn't be as high. And so they pulled out the 3 stops. And that's what got Isaiah and a lot of organizations like it to organize. And they organized in an extremely effective way. And what they really ended up doing was starting to build essentially, well, what would be the impact on health? For the people that lived there over time. What would be the economic impact? What would be the impact on health? And they really not only did that, so it wasn't just a policy solution, which in many ways would have gone nowhere in that state, but they ended up going door to door, one-on-one, organizing and building a base of power with the goal of not only getting in these 3 stops, but with the goal of essentially making sure that this type of thought, this type of governance would not be the type of governance that the state would have. And it was in that process that they really, I think, found an incredibly interesting mix of building power and voice, along with using information about health in really effective ways. And I have to tell you that for a person like myself, I'd really never understood organizing. And I was immediately told when I got there that you people in public health or in healthcare think you're organizing, but what you're doing is event planning. You don't know what organizing is. And I really got to understand it as a discipline, as a way of doing things, as a way of actually activating people to build power and to transform themselves in the process. Not just like on a Facebook page or click a petition. It was a real process of transformation, knowledge, or realization that helped the community build power. And it was incredibly important for me personally because in some ways, if you didn't get that that's what it would take, you could have spent still all of your time around sector strategies or technology or cost or information or policy and stuck in some ways in these safer spaces of looking at, again, technical issues, which people with, again, my type of background or training might have been gravitated towards. And, you know, for me, finally, a place that I'll mention, which is comes very close to home, is that I began to really appreciate what my wife does. My wife, Manmeet Kaur, started an organization called City Health Works. And her background is she worked with organizing construction laborers in India. The way that it usually works in India is that people come for their day construction job. They just show up, they get the people that they want, tell everybody to go away, and you come back the next day like you've had never had any experience. You just line up again and again. As a result, there's really no ID systems, there's no bank accounts, there's no health insurance, there's no reputation, there's no expertise, there's no safety built into the industry. And so it becomes very important to actually build and organize people to build strong job foundations in that context. She went to South Africa and built a sustainable business with HIV-positive workers, a yogurt business, so that they gain the confidence to actually sell in townships and so forth in settings where they would have otherwise felt very uncomfortable. And she began to understand the power of peers to be able to actually help people break through a lot of barriers that they may personally have held. So in Harlem, she started an organization called City Health Works, which trains and manages health coaches that are from the neighborhood. And her goal was to do so in a way that would be financially independent over time and able to grow. And it was incredible to me because as I came back in this travel across the country and there were other stories of people that I encountered, I really got to understand that what I was doing in my 15-minute visits with my patients in my primary care clinic, giving them news like, hey, you're a new diabetic, you're gonna have to change your life, and then saying, you know, please talk to somebody for an hour on the way out, and you know, good luck navigating this new landscape of your life, was in some ways the work that she would have to pick up on the other side. And the coaches in the neighborhood would then actually do the real work of helping somebody start to understand how their life would have to change in the context of their neighborhood. What does that mean when you go into a grocery store and you've just been given a list by your doc of all the things you can't do, and those are the things that you spent your life eating? What do you do next? If you have EBT or food stamps, how is that gonna actually change? What are you gonna be, how are you gonna be cooking differently? And that's just on the food axis. There's so many other dimensions. So much of it has to do with confidence. So much of it has to do with motivation, understanding where our goals aligned between what people want in their lives and ultimately what is it that might make them healthier from a healthcare perspective. And I think it's been an incredible growth in our relationship, to just see what is this deep interdependence of the sector strategy view, which I still am very much firmly ensconced in, as leading a part of a healthcare system. And what is it that this other view of a neighborhood as an infrastructure, the real infrastructure for healthier lives, what does it actually take to close that loop? And what would it mean, what will it mean for us if we ignore all of that and it remains missing? And so, you know, I think I wanna just pause and start taking some questions, but I think one thing that I'm just absolutely spend my time thinking a lot about is as we have the very important discussions that we're about to have and the fights that we will have to have about ensuring that people have access to healthcare, there's something potentially Pyrrhic inside of all of it where, you know, somebody can have won on either side and yet Americans can lose the day people across the country will not be healthier for it. Ray's grandchildren who grow up in Harlem will live no healthier lives, potentially less so than their grandfather did. And it's because we somehow don't get it that there's this connective piece about a whole different view, a different lens on what does it actually take to build, what does it mean to connect and actually find useful solutions, even though you can't explain all of them in 1 to 2 sentences, that are in fact absolutely necessary and requisite. What will it take for us to be proactive to make that a normative view, that is in fact the work? Strengthening the sector and the reform and the cost efforts are actually still very important, but they in fact are in some ways a self-negating cycle if we don't actually begin to think about and build solutions and focus on solutions and make sure that people shift their lens onto that. I don't know about you, but I've been hearing a lot of people around me saying, oh, we got to get great people to run for every possible political office around us. And as we do, in some ways, we're already offering them a choice, defend the ACA or make sure that you're on the right side of the Affordable Care Act, you know. And that's a litmus test in some basic way for whether or not we support at least a certain type of candidate these days. But I have to say that we also, especially if you're in health, have to do some better educating and make sure that we have better choices on the table. It isn't just about whether or not somebody did their job in political office about defending or not the Affordable Care Act. We have to recognize that is in some ways only half or less of what we actually have to accomplish ahead of ourselves. And what I found to be inspiring in my work over this last couple years writing this book is actually finding those pioneers across the country who are actually building and finding these solutions, including very large networks, including the 100 Million Healthier Lives campaign and networks that were actually connecting up all these different neighborhoods and these pioneers so that they were solution networks you could start to plug into. And that's something that I'm excited to see grow and I think will intensify. But in some basic sense, if we don't recognize that is in fact the work ahead, you know, we will really never make the progress that we ought to in the days ahead. So let me pause here, and I'd love to take some questions from all of you.
Thank you, Dr. Singh.
My name is Swati.
Swati, great to meet you.
My question is, you talk about connection and connecting these communities together, but as you described, these communities are very diverse and disparate, and you went to different parts of the country. Understanding how these communities came together, so can you talk a little bit about what did connection mean in each one of these different areas? How are they similar and how are they different?
Yeah, great. This is a critically important question, because in some ways you can just present people, hey, there were nice bright spots across the country and good luck to you when you encounter the same problem in your own. One of the most important things that I think I saw over the last few years is the growth of, there's essentially, for example, let me make this concrete. Let's say that you are struggling with addiction, opiates, and unemployment in your community. There are groups of people across the country that actually really have thought about what do you do in these situations? What do you do not only from a medical perspective, but also from an employment perspective, and how do you start to reorganize faith-based communities and have them reorient themselves? The challenge is that if you're a community in rural Washington, for instance, your ability to kind of find and search and connect to that group of people that may have those solutions, or mentor communities that have actually gone through this process, without doing anything, it's incredibly low. You have to have an incredibly motivated person that just makes it their life's issue to get right out there, and even if they do, they're gonna probably be bewildered by all of the technical people they encounter, all of the intimidating other barriers that you have to go to find these people, and you wouldn't even potentially recognize it when you got there. So one of the most useful things I saw was a way of organizing hubs of expertise around 20 or so areas, making sure that all of those people knew each other. A way of creating essentially mentor and pace setter communities, kind of like communities that had gone through certain types of change that were in some ways kind of indexed and well known across a network. and making it increasingly easier for people from communities to search, essentially. So, you know, I still have a technical mind. It's incredibly, I will get back to some technology analogies, but this isn't about technology. This is about the question of if you have an issue, how many jumps will it take for you to find out really good solutions? And what will it take for you to find out how could your community solve in the same ways that maybe five or six other communities solved? What will it take for you to hear what happened in a West Virginia community, what happened in a Mississippi community that might be analogous to what you might have to go through in rural Washington? These are the sort of networks that I've seen start to form, and I describe them in the third part of the book, who they are. So if you're like, literally, actually, who do I talk to? Who do I contact? Those are becoming increasingly easier to search and find. And the million community healthier, the 100 million healthier lives campaign, which is actually sponsored by an organization called the Institute for Healthcare Improvement, which was started by a gentleman named Don Berwick in Boston. They've moved from being kind of a classic technical organization to really making sure that they feel like a community and kind of networked movement across the country, so they're less intimidating, and it's easier to find people that have gone through experiences like you. So it's kind of peer work at the community level that is easier to search through. Now, it's gonna take a lot more work for you to be at the fingertips and say, hey, I've got an issue, I know who to talk to. But that is a very practical set of steps that at least people across the country are making so that at least you can start to find and search people better and more easily. If you're trained in healthcare, it's very easy to find pulmonologists or critical care doctors or cardiologists. You just, you know, it's very easy to find these people. People that have arcane specialties, you can find them like that. Even if you're a patient and you want to find the one expert on a, you know, an orphan condition, you can find those people. But that type of organization is part of what makes it a powerful sector. And that's a type of infrastructure that needs to be developed and built on the neighborhood-oriented side. And that is starting to happen. And it's going to take a lot more work to make it possible.
Hello. My name's Amaranthia, and I'm a domestic violence and sexual assault advocate. And I just was wondering if you could speak maybe a little bit more about, I know the story you told about the Dallas program and some of the ways that they were sharing information. I wonder if you could speak a little bit about some of the concerns or how to blend or balance that with privacy and confidentiality, as well as just, I know there are different databases and tracking things that sometimes get proposed around like the homelessness population here in Seattle, and I'm just curious about, like, sometimes that can lead actually to like service rationing or a feeling of like you're taking too many things that you're not supposed to get or whatever. So anyway, just a few of those thoughts, and then also, you know, so often there's a lot of ways that there's a criminalization and kind of the state imposes on certain things around health. So what comes to mind is like HIV, HIV/AIDS, and infecting others if you know about your own status but not informing others of that status. So just kind of all those things are floating through my head, and I wonder if you could just speak to some of those ideas.
Sure.
Thanks.
I might in some ways channel Doran, who I mentioned earlier, this incredibly, somebody who I've really come to admire, and I still listen for and call and ask her how she's thinking through things. And in some basic sense, what she might say in response is on the privacy or confidentiality issues, in some ways that you haven't had the conversations you need to in that community setting or even with the people you think you're helping. There's in fact not a real way that conversations have actually been structured. And so, you know, I think each one of those examples merits a much deeper kind of conversation, but in some basic sense, it is automatically tips you off that you've had technical conversations, but you actually haven't done some of the deep work surfacing the tensions, addressing the kind of core issues of your, you know, you can call them clients, users, or participants, or people that actually should have a role in designing what that care should look like. One thing that we've done at Mount Sinai in my group is that we have a very strong user design group, service design group, and product design group. And just like kind of modern technology companies, whenever we're designing care models or thinking about other ways to do things, we immediately bring in kind of user testing, user design, user preferences, and thinking about how do you design services with a whole range of users in mind. It's a type of thinking that, again, organized sectors are increasingly doing. But if we don't really take seriously that this is actually how we should be thinking in an organized way around how do we design these interactions, how do people feel in the process, what's the experience look like, what's the user journey through an interaction, those are all actually very tangible, practical things that you can do to start at least unpacking what are the real issues versus the perceived issues. When do people have genuine challenge with privacy, and what are just kind of regulatory things that are blanketed over? We make a lot of assumptions in how we design a lot of this care to protect, even on that side, that are actually unfounded. And so it cuts both ways, and I think it speaks to a mindlessness to some degree, and also a solvable issue on the other side. It requires effort and energy on design.
Could you comment on, well, I guess your opinion about the profit motive and insurance companies and that whole piece of it, and if, in your opinion, that holds us back from making real progress, and how we could sort of break that hold that the profit motive and insurance companies have on, I think, general wellness?
Sounds like a leading question. Just kidding. That's a great, it's a centrally important question. So, you know, I think one of the major concessions of the Affordable Care Act was that it was actually designed very carefully with payers in mind, because the Affordable Care Act is really largely about shifts in financial models. And so, you know, the way that a person like Ray was taken care of in the past was that anything that you did for Ray was, a dollar sign went up, a dollar sign went up. And the focus there, of course, if you're in the sector, you would know, was volume. Getting more stuff done became the word of the day. If you're a hospital, you ran it like a hotel. You wanted heads in beds. You wanted all the heads in beds filled. And in some basic sense, you wanted people to be lined up, you know, as close to the end or issues, and then you just start kind of taking them through the paces. And we know that in the last 6 months or 6 weeks of life, costs escalate, you know, exponentially in many settings. So in some sense, some of the large transitions that we're seeing is to paying people for outcomes or value, but that is a shift that in fact has, I think, taken place, catalyzed by the Affordable Care Act, and in my view is here to stay, at least on the payment side. There's very strong commercial, private sector reasons why that trend is moving forward in at least our regional areas. But it's insufficient to just do the payment changes without actually changing the care models underneath. And that's essentially where, if we get kind of log jammed right now and essentially don't see a lot of this work through, you're kind of really neither here nor there. So where insurance companies and payers in all of this, sometimes they're the most motivated people to help you redesign things. Sometimes they're saying, why isn't this hospital thinking ahead? Because we've got, you know, financial challenges. And on the other side, very organized, large healthcare payers are doing extraordinarily well and will continue to do so because they've really figured out how to use the sector strategy and scale to their advantage. And so in some sense, it's actually very important to understand who are your local providers. What are they trying to do? You should get to know them. You should talk to them. They're people. Payers in the insurance companies. And you know, ask them, what are they doing around these issues? They probably share a lot of the same concerns, but they probably don't see, you know, what you're seeing. When it comes to very large national payers, it's a different ballgame. And we can name names if we want. Again, I think what's more important is, are you going to be fighting this as a sector strategy question, or are you going to focus on what actually needs to be built and done? Former is important, but if there's really no clear vision about the goal and mission on the latter side, you can't accomplish it. There's really no path to victory without a goal that's clear, without a citizenry that actually knows what it means to be healthy, and that what they're being offered is not that.
Thank you, Dr. Singh. My name's Isaac. I have a question about healthcare and education as it applies to this sector strategy and the neighborhood view. A lot of the things many of us are calling for in healthcare have the basic idea of a sector strategy that healthcare should look more like education, that it should be treated like a public good, that a basic package or basic level of care should be guaranteed to everyone, that there should be more democratic governance of what that looks like, that there should be a more sensible, potentially a single payer financing of it. And yet at the same time, if we look specifically at schools, we see these really big inequalities that most of us are unhappy with. And so I'm wondering, you know, the mechanisms we have in public education in this country, like school boards, or the charter school movement recently, are these, you know, the kinds of neighborhood view initiatives that you would like to see in healthcare, or are you seeing a neighborhood view of healthcare that's pretty different from the way that we approach public education?
Great, great question. So I would say pretty different, and let me kind of back away from that. I think also that view of what education is as a public good, you should probably make sure you send some notes to DeVos. She'll need to review many of them, I think, as she makes some decisions. The lack of it, I'm in situations where I can make some of these missives and there's chuckling, but there's really also, you know, really serious, again, question about what does it look like to constitute a great education, what does it look like to constitute, you know, an excellent health system. And I think one of the challenges is that we're often really focusing upon some of these mechanics pieces, just like as we have over the last 4 or 5 years, and have not really been clear about what does it look like for it to succeed at the level of an individual. So what does it look like for, aside from kind of describing the policies of a kind of a core curriculum, for instance, what does it actually look like for somebody to kind of develop into a healthy education? There's so many ways to game the other one. It's much harder to say, okay, this person is actually educated and ready for the world. This person is genuinely healthy and has participated in their care. So one thing that I think, I gave a Lancet podcast the other few weeks ago, and I said on that podcast that I don't support single payer system at this juncture. And a lot of my colleagues were like, what are you saying? I'd say for the following few reasons. One is that, that's really not how healthcare education is constituted. It's not constituted as kind of a federal single payer system, for instance. It's not, I think, a great analogy in that regards. It's discretionary spending that's done at the state and then local levels, and it can be, if you look at Kansas, extraordinarily depleted and bankrupted. And so it's vulnerable in a different sort of way. On the healthcare side, why I wouldn't necessarily support a single payer system is that I don't think we really thought about the mechanics of implementing it. And so I think as much as it is a rhetorical flourish to move forward, I don't think we need particularly any more rhetoric about how do we get the payments in a certain way. We have to do some alignment in terms of what does actually care look like, what it ought to look like. So let me answer now in the affirmative. So where are there actually connections and analogies that work well? We know, for instance, that if you're a kid, it's actually important to look at schools as actually a hub for health. And so on a very practical level, if you think about a child as a user of both a health and education system at the same time, for them to be sick and then have to go into a health system, pulling their parents out, especially if they're potentially low income, putting a lot of things at risk, you know, four other issues become at risk: employment for their parents, transportation questions, getting to the right services. You've actually generated a huge set of user problems in just a very simple kind of like lack of thoughtful way that we've, again, organized by sector. We've really not thought about that user moving through a pathway. And so to just kind of get a little bit on the technical side, there's an economist, Heckman, that's really focused over the last, he's a Nobel Prize winner from Chicago, who's focused very much about what is it, how important it is to have kind of integrated early childhood experiences. And that's come in the news in so many different ways over the last few years. But what that really emphasizes is that you have to really think about what are these common user pathways that people go through and how do you design service interactions or support interactions in ways that actually make sense to the patterns that people live their lives. And that's a radically different view from saying we need to fund X sector to a higher degree to balance out something or the other and make it on parity with the UK. Because you can do all of those things and still essentially really mess up the user design questions. And I have to say, you know, after I spent time really looking at our situation in East Harlem, East Harlem is one of the number one places in the country that every single progressive bill, idea, policy, effort has gone to in the last 40 years. Whether it's been the great idea of very large public health towers, public housing buildings all packed together. They were called Parks in the Sky by Le Corbusier. This kind of visionary view of having these towers coming out of these small parks. It's not how people feel about it today. And there's, again, really a question in there about, are we solving for a sector strategy and saying in theory and policy these things ought to make sense to be funded in certain ways? Or are we genuinely thinking about how users interact and how their lives are and how they work? I think people shy away at some level from that view, because they're like, well, people are so different. But again, I'd ask you, like, if a kid gets sick in school, what happens to them? Where can they go? Would it be better to have school be a hub for health and have a nurse co-located there as part of a actual, you know, paid system? That's a choice. That's a design question. And so I think that there has to be some concordance and focus on what is it that we're actually solving for before we start putting forward the mechanisms that we think might actually get to that solution. We have been a little bit, I think, I worked with a lot of economists. I really respect a lot of economists that I've worked with. But there is a language around just incentives and behavioral design, which in many ways skirts, well, what is it? What do you have to do? What is it that people have to do? Not what are you kind of creating environments where you're nudging, you're kind of suggesting, you're kind of motivating or incenting. All of those are kind of secondary, tertiary pieces of language that, you know, you get odd effects. Because you didn't actually say, well, what ought to happen? What would be an excellent goal or outcome of this process? What does it look like to be continuously successful onto the next level? You know, and I think those are some of the questions that I would ask before I went to say, okay, this is the broad mechanism. It ought to look like X mechanism in another sector. I do think that there has to be a significant redesign on that front. And I think that some of the things that are even currently being, I wish that some of the things that are coming to the table now by the Republican Congress, I wish that progressives had taken them on and really thought through what would it have taken to kind of free up healthcare spending and social sector spending and design how it should actually interact at the neighborhood level. Because frankly, that's going to happen now, and it's not going to necessarily happen in ways that are thoughtful about design.
Doctor, my name's Marianne Gillis. I'm from Baltimore. I'm a land use planner. I worked there for 25 years in neighborhoods. And I would like to ask you, what is the impact of the individually owned vehicle car at the neighborhood level? What's the impact on health?
Oof. I have to tell you, I don't know. I think, but you might have an idea, is my guess, of what it is. I think I can only speak a bit more broadly that if we had well-designed public transport systems like a lot of modern economies, probably be in a better shape. We saw that in the three stops situation that I showed you. You know, the cost of having a car to drive employment opportunities and go to places, I mean, it's stunning what it actually takes. That startup cost is huge. So beyond speaking, you know, to the level of what I saw as being common sense across the country, I couldn't answer that in a way that I think would honor the spirit and the knowledge that you have of that question myself. I will say that there's some interesting things afoot. You know, I felt variously about Uber over the years. You know, negatively, positively, ambivalent user, negative, positive, you know, so forth, so on, right? And you know, it changes, and you know, it clearly says that there's some sort of like digestion process that takes place with technologies, and it's kind of sometimes tumultuous interaction with the world. But for instance, Mount Sinai is now partnering with Uber to actually make sure that patients that are Medicaid patients that are high need or need to be come to the clinic, if they have any transportation issues, we will send an Uber out to get them and bring them back. And it's infinitely better for us than these kind of really terrible ambulance services that we have in New York City. I'm not sure how it is in Seattle, but you know, they won't wait for you for a second. You know, nobody really, what's that?
It's the same,
yeah. I'm not terribly surprised, but the user design around those services is like a true disaster. And so I think, those are examples where something around transportation is changing and obviously a critical element to this. I'd also speak to some elements of what does mobility mean, because there's being mobile in your community, there's being mobile to get to opportunities around. I wish I knew a lot more about it. It seems very important. And I think the nice thing about this is you don't need to, as a physician, know the answer to these questions. I just need to know you. And then we can start to design together.
Hi, Dr. Singh. Thank you so much for the presentation. I really enjoyed it. My name's Daniela, and I was wondering, in the course of medical school, how many classes or courses are spent on studying what the needs of economically disadvantaged neighborhoods might be in terms of what they experience that are prevalent health issues versus other neighborhoods? And if not, do you see that that could be an important potential change or in the education system from your side?
Yeah, great, phenomenal question.
And substance abuse as well, addiction.
Yeah, great question. I went to Cornell Medical School, wow. following that, flourish of pride is nothing. We had no classes on, no classes on nutrition that I recall. Oddly enough, the eye was missing, I think, from our education, at least when I went through school. On a serious note, and I'll kind of now take this to a more important, kind of like, I take the spirit of your question and I think answer it in a way that I hope gets, I think, to a greater point, which is, no, we didn't have that. And I've seen over the last few years, medical schools try to put in a week or a few pieces of education around social determinants of health, for instance, a kind of a general broad brush over housing, transport, and for people that care about it, it's engaging. They're like, yes, I'm glad it's there. For the 90% of a class that is not necessarily primed towards it, it doesn't actually like deeply resonate. And I've found that I don't think that there's enough kind of like sophistication and depth of expertise that sits on the healthcare side that will go to a medical school class and then design a pedagogical activity that will be engaging. That's like a lot of steps to get to the point where you actually take a different type of user that has to have an experience, a medical student, and create the kind of breadcrumbs and red thread to get them to do that self-exploration, which is really the driver of where people actually find their path in medical school. Everybody gets a little bit off the shelf, you know, for a lot of issues, and then people generally go, I think, at least my experience was you just go yourself, and then you kind of burrow and explore until you find yourself in some small niche, usually inside medicine. And if you didn't have that type of exposure in a manner that kind of pulls you and speaks to some of the reasons why you tick, then it doesn't go very far. And so the dosing is very low to begin with, compared to like the number of classes that we had on like amino acid biology. And so there's an obvious mismatch there. I think that there lacks a courage in a lot of medical training, residency, and medical school to actually ask ourselves, what is it that we need to decommission? What needs to actually be commissioned further? And that's because it's generally ruled by like committees that can say no to things, but not yes to things. And that's the structure of a lot of how academic medical centers are organized. Let me give you a few bright spots. Dell Medical School and University of Texas, Austin, just launched last year. It received $2 billion to start the medical school from the tax base of Travis County. Every single Travis County resident has on their tax bill, Dell Medical School, and their obligation is to serve the population of Travis County, and they've built their entire research agenda, their training agenda on that basic premise. I genuinely wish them enormous success. I think they're very innovative. They're cutting edge. I think that they have a greater chance of breaking through what we ought to actually do than, frankly, I think a creative medical school. Like, I think Mount Sinai is a creative medical school, but they have the advantage of being able to think fresh. University of Utah is incorporating elements of service design and user design in. And in some ways, it seems like a less intuitive way to think about how do you get people to think about neighborhoods or housing or transportation. But if you give somebody a tool that they can use all the time to just think about the person there in front of them and how do they interact with their environment, you actually don't just like lead them to water, but you give them an idea of like, well, what is it that you're even thinking about or looking around with? You give them a capability. I think those end up being more powerful ways to engage, and we're experimenting with them at Mount Sinai. And it's part of why we're really trying to wrap in what we're doing at the Arnhold Institute around design. We have data science teams, we have people that think about connectivity and policy, but then how do we translate that back into training is very important. And I have to say, you know, internal medicine training is, I think dismal at this juncture across the nation, in part because it really exits people into the sector who are completely unprepared for the kind of enormous dynamism that's taken place. That mismatch will have its comeuppance, and people don't oftentimes forget that the last big cataclysms in medicine and what constitutes a medical degree were only in the mid last century. And they actually happen like cyclically every 60 years. So, you know, we're like due. I think it's important for instead of something else to, you know, truly be schismatic, it's really important that we, I think, take more responsibility as professionals for stewarding the right type of training. It's not working for our trainees. They're really burnt out and stressed in ways that are not healthy. And I don't think it leads to a type of physician that we want to be the future of what physicians are. They may be fine for now and deeply compassionate people, but they're not equipped with what they need.
Hi, Camelia.
Hi, Camille.
Wondering if a well-organized community program can ultimately ripple into and quell the end-of-life costs that you spoke about, or do you think that is so ballooned out of control that it requires a sector-based approach or something else?
Great question. I have the fortune of working with an extraordinary woman named Diane Meyer. Diane Meyer has built and led the palliative care movement across the country. She has really come to the realization that the goal is not just to create palliative care physicians, but community-based palliative care with health coaches and so forth is absolutely critical for us to move forward. For those of you that are not familiar with palliative care, there were some stunning pieces of news to the healthcare community. It turns out that in late stage lung cancer, if you do not treat somebody with chemo and you just focus on quality of life and their decisions, they live a higher quality of life at lower cost and they live longer. They live longer. And you know, it's in all directions better. And it makes you start to think, if there wasn't a trial, high quality New England Journal of Medicine trial, what are we doing? In a whole bunch of other dimensions where the default is to go pedal to the metal till the end and make you feel like you didn't do a good job if you didn't fight. And so, you know, I think there are just basic conversations as caregivers, as family members, we need to learn to have. There are people in communities that need to help us through that process. There's a role for the faith-based community to really take a central role in a lot of these conversations, because as I saw in East Harlem, where we have an extremely strong base of very involved churches and mosques in care, that there can be a huge tension point until you start to talk to a reverend or a pastor or an imam and say, hey, this is a different way to think about it. So I think the bottom line is that we'll never produce enough palliative care physicians. The sector strategy and you are a palliative care physician, I think it's an incredible field and I admire it, but they're not enough. And there will not be enough. And it is not the only channel. And I think if we believe that it is the only channel to grow, then we'll be failing the nation again.
So you spent a little bit of time talking about the fact that traditional medical schools don't have much in the way of this kind of training. But I think there's a program you're probably familiar with in New York City that probably has a relationship with Mount Sinai. It's the Sophie Davis Center for Biomedical Education,
yep.
which is where I went to school. And we visited neighborhood healthcare centers. We had people who were involved with barefoot doctors and the programs down in Alabama with, you know, serving the poor people from Chile who were teaching us. And so there was a lot of that. I don't know. It's a small school that had about, I don't know, 70 or 80 graduates per year when I was there. But do you know if they've had any sort of influence on the general direction of the way people are being trained? Because the concept of that program was to train inner city physicians
yeah.
who were, and from the get-go, from age 18, were visiting patients in their home, seeing them, seeing the places and the yeah. ways they yeah. live. So can you comment a little bit about that?
Yeah.
That model?
So I think this is an important question, in part because, A, first of all, Sophie Davis, I'm not sure if you followed the story, but it's now become CUNY Medical School.
Right.
So it's actually experienced a huge amount of growth, and there'll be a lot of investment into the medical school, I hope. And they have an opportunity to redesign how they do things along the way. But, you know, on one hand, I do write and work on neighborhood-based care, but on the other hand, I still stay very much and closely with sector strategies, with fiscal strategies, with how the profession at its political and its economic and prestige base is moving, because it's very important to move both of these and shift all of it as you move. One of the dangers I find is that if there becomes kind of like a self-marginalization of community health falling into that part of the academic medical center, of these ideas becoming fringe, that is a cycle that propagates very deeply. Medical students that are only ideologically aligned go in that direction. Effort, as it kind of goes from a sector level, will only go, you know, at the margins. And so I think that it's incredibly important to have a group of people that really understand what the positive vision can be, should be, and to form that kind of moving front. But it's also really important for other people sitting at various other parts of the sector, whether you're a cardiac surgeon or you are you know, thinking about policy all day, which is great, but what are you doing to kind of reconcile this? And I think I spent a lot of time trying to write a book that might give language to people that might not see themselves as community health people, but can also start to connect the dots and give them their own language as they do so. How successfully I did that is, you know, up to you. But I think there's at least a couple parts of that. One is, yes, I think it's important for those people. It's overarching influence, I'm not sure. Certainly not, you know, across the street at Cornell where I was trained, you know, this was largely an absent view from my training.
So we have enough time for just one or two more questions.
There's some areas of medicine where sometimes trust can sort of be an issue in clinical care, like maybe pediatrics or psychiatry or oncology. Can you speak, when you were traveling around, did you observe any sort of creative solutions to overcoming that challenge when trying to establish community solutions to the problems?
Great question. Maybe I'll start before the community solutions to just how are we trained formally to establish and forge trust? I'd say that we're generally not. Meaning that you are generally selected into medical school with the belief that you're the type of person that ought to be a good doctor. And that is meant to be modeled by the people that are your physician attendings and so forth as we move through. And what you become at the end is a function of how much you picked up that modeling and that you gravitate towards it. So it's really kind of like if you are inclined, you'll kind of increasingly grow in that area. And if you're not, you know, you can kind of pass right through it in terms of what are the concrete skills that you need to have. I found it very heartening that, for example, a technique from psychology, motivational interviewing, is entering in as a concrete skill that at least parts of the medical enterprise are being trained in. So motivational interviewing is kind of simply goal alignment. If you're really steeped in that training, then you'll say, hey, you're watering this down terribly. But and I appreciate that, and you're right. But for the sake of this, there is questions about how do you establish rapport, how do you do the goal alignment, And I actually have seen, for example, the training that I've received in palliative care, the little snippets that I have, they have a lot of tools to rapidly forge trust and to start going through kind of what does an open and honest conversation look like that's informed and at the same time generates the right type of, instead of false choices, but right choices, or how do you think about that whole process with somebody? So I think that there's kind of the general, how do you kind of forge trust in general? And you know, that's a complicated thing to do. But I think when you start to speak about what are the concrete skills that we need to build in people, it starts at this very basic level of motivational interviewing. There's types of skills that we can build along the way. And one thing that I've been thinking a lot about through our work is, what does it look like to forge trust at a systems level? I'll give you an example that if we have had this Medicaid redesign in New York State, an $8 billion effort across the state to redesign how Medicaid services are done with 200 community partners around Mount Sinai. Mount Sinai got $400 million, we have 200 partners, and then they were said, okay, you have 18 months, figure this out. When you have the the ability to put $400 million across and choose 200 organizations in an 18-month cycle, it turns out it's an extremely terrible way to forge trust. It will do the opposite in many ways. And so there's even kind of this basic policy design questions about what is it that you're trying to accomplish in this process that we have to really learn into. What does system level trust building actually look like? And that's why I gave you the example of the Parkland, Dallas example. Because they had really, and there's a lot more depth to it, but they really had, you know, in some ways, technology was the afterthought of that story, but it really was how they had gone about to forge trust across 400 organizations with a safety net system that did not have a reputation as doing that in the past. That process is what I really explored, and you'll see that in the second part of the book, forging trust at the system level, at the citizen level, at the personal level, and then inside healthcare is a core theme of how you actually are able to do the design work that pushes people forward. I think it's an issue that should be explored with greater depth, and the tools should become richer, because that's probably going to be the pathway to get us to move forward. Thanks, though. Well, thank you very much.